Okay, hello. We're going to talk about how to use the Lotus Web3 client contract. You can read more about it at this address. But the core idea, I'll go over for a minute here. So on Filecoin, after the NV17 network version, which is coming in a couple weeks, the built-in market actor is going to ask for authentication on deal proposals from an arbitrary contract. So what we can do is build this client contract in such a way that we can control what data gets accepted. This client contract is the main content of this repo. This repo also has a mocked out market actor, which you'll also be able to use the main Filecoin mock contract to mock out. The storage provider is out of the picture today, but once we have a Wallaby network which is properly interacting with built-in actors, then things will look a little bit different. So for today, what am I going to demo? I'm going to show you how to build the contracts in this repo, how to deploy them to Wallaby, and then how to publish a mock deal which will be accepted by the client contract after we've added in CID as authorized. I will note that while this contract is simple, there are a lot of ideas, some of which are down here, for different things you can do on top of this. It's also upcoming work and a lot of other good things, so you should read this repo fairly thoroughly. Assuming you've done that, then we can get on to the demo of how to use the basic flow. So I'll show you there's these two contracts which we're going to be building. There's the deal client, which does the authorization. And then there's the mock market, which again, you could probably use the main one, the main mock contract instead. It should also have this publish deal thing. But I'm going to deploy both. The flow I'm going to do, number one, I'm going to add a CID to the deal client so that it will authorize that CID. And number two, I'm going to make this mocked out deal, which will call into the deal client at this handle Filecoin method. And then that will trigger the deal client to determine that the deal is, or I guess that the CID of the deal is being tracked. And the way that we'll see that is that we'll get a new provider in our mapping from data CID to provider. I guess data CID to provider to Boolean. This will have an entry once we get a provider. Okay, enough setup. Let's actually make this thing work. So the deal client contract project on the main branch is a good place to start. What you're going to need is Forge, which is basically Rust cargo for Solidity. It's a pretty nice tool. Helped me learn the Solidity ecosystem pretty well. You're probably familiar with it or tools like it. There are just raw Solidity contracts that you can build however you want in here, but if you want to use the tooling, then you can run make build. And that should work pretty well. After that, you're going to take the bytecode, and we're going to launch these things onto Wallaby, which I have running over here. So I've got a Lotus daemon running. I've got some testnet fill. I'm going to do just a little bit of changing around my terminal so I can do some copy paste. I think I've actually done this already, but let's take a look. Let's just paste that in here. Looks the same. And let's get rid of the OX at the start because Lotus doesn't like that. So there's our deal client hex. And then we can go into Lotus chain, create EVM actor, hex, deal client hex. And we should have testnet fill. So good, this is ready to go. Okay, and then I'm going to create the mock so that I can actually make a deal with this thing. So we already built. Let's go with Lotus. Inspect, then we can go deal client, mock market. And then in parallel. Played myself, not going back to screen, but that's okay. We can wait around a little bit. I guess we can get ready over here for what we're going to do with these actors. So Forge also has this nice inspect message infos. And we're going to want to be using these to be making our calls. Okay, sweet. Let's get back onto, actually, let's stay out of screen and let's get to go mock market hex. And that's that. And again, kill that. And there we go. So now we have the two hexes. Let's go back to screen. And now let's say Lotus chain create EVM actor hex mock market hex. Okay, so now that's running. So the first thing we want to do is add the CID to the client. The way that I've set up the MVP contract client is to very simply trust the creator of the client to add in the CID from an off-chain message, which will then be authorized. Of course, all the interesting stuff is related to extending this and other functionalities into something more interesting, I don't know, more complex. There's this contract itself. I guess I'm just saying don't judge the potential for the basicness of this guy. But we're going to want to use this add CID thing. Okay. And as a fairly rookie Solidity developer, I always have some trouble with this. Looks like I've done something similar. I can maybe just use my shell history to help me out with. Ah, there we go. Yeah. So I want to add, right. So I'm going to encode stuff for adding a CID, which if you're familiar with Solidity should be very intuitive to you. So I will say, where did I get this from? This is really for our purposes because we're using mock, so like the CIDs are probably not real. This I think is a real CID that I just generated from some test code. But yeah, I guess that's the answer. I generated some of this stuff from test codes. What you can do to bring this back is grab data from the tests in this repo. In particular, bring it back to this one. This is a deal proposal that's serialized to CBOR in the same way that Filecoin would do it. And this is what you're going to be sending to the mock market. But yeah, let's not get ahead of ourselves. We'll get back to that. Let's see. So I think we've got everything created. So we made the mock market like this. And I forgot the name of my other contract. Quickly, I'll come back here. Yeah, okay. So the deal client contract is at T01095. So I'll go back there. And okay, I'm going to add that. So I'm going to go invoke EVM actor. And then this is my thing. That's my address. And then ABI encode. This is the ABI encoded stuff, but I need the Solidity endpoint for add CID, which is this guy. So da da da, da da da. Okay, so this should add a CID to the Solidity contract. And of course, I've forgotten my OX. So let's get rid of that. And we'll wait for that to go. So while we're waiting, because this will take a little bit of time, I'm going to play around with CBOR so that you can see what's going on with the deal proposal. So again, I'll really quickly show you. This is the deal proposal bytes. And it's actually a wrapped set of data, so it's actually what will be passed directly into the authenticate message callee from the built-in actors. It's like a signature and a piece of data, basically. And it's getting ahead. So what this is in CBOR is an array of two things. So this is a null signature from the mock data that I'm generating it with, and then there's 76 bytes, which are themselves a deal proposal encoded in CBOR, and we can take a look at that. CBOR.me is a very nice site for this, as you probably could tell. So yeah, this is a deal proposal. It's 11 items. It's a data CID right here. This is how we tag them with 42, and then this is CBOR bytes. And then we also have the data size, which I encoded earlier. If you remember, we used 2048. As the data size. And then there's also the verified status. This is not verified. And then there's the client and the provider. Yeah, so this is the CBOR data. The contract parses it for you, so you can rely on that. If you want to do more interesting things with this proposal, you're going to need to extend the CBOR parsing, but the functions should be structured in such a way that that's not too hard for you. you will need to learn a little bit about CBOR and about this structure. Where's the structure specified? If you go to built-in actors, so this is a good place. So this is from like Filecoin Project. On Filecoin Project GitHub, you can go to built-in actors. You can go to source, wait, hold on, actors, market, source, deal. And this is a deal proposal. So PCID, P size, verified deal. This is all the CBOR encoding happens from a structure that looks like this. And then that CBOR encoding populates this. This is the way to know what it looks like. So if you wanted to do an extension, which for example did something about price, you would need to learn how to both read something out of this, and then you need to learn how to parse the token amount type, which is, you know, it's work, but it's not crazy. So yeah, that's the data we're using. And I think at this point we've probably added our great. So we've added our CID. So what I want to do now on Wallaby is just check and see, hey, is the CID there? And what I'm going to do to do that, I think, let's try cast. I think I might not even need to ABI encode because it's a single. No, okay, yeah. This is exactly what I want. Okay, yeah, sure. I do need to because things are packed in a certain way. But this is the parameter for reading the CID size. So when we have for the really basic contract that is in this repo, it tracks the size of the CID. This is important. And I guess, sorry, I should be saying the size of the data behind the CID. The name is maybe not great. The reason we'd want to do this, you could potentially see. So if your data is Merkleized, then you could truncate at a topper at a higher level at the top of a tree and include that, and you could still get the same hash. I mean, that's maybe not so important to know right now. I think this size stuff is important, and maybe there's some way you can get around including it. But what I really care about it right now is it's a good way to check that this thing actually works with the state. So we have a getter on the size mapping from CID to size. So what we're gonna do is invoke this thing. Same guy. It's this method and it's these bytes. And again, no OX. Okay. So we'll let that go. What I'm hoping to see is 2048 come out of here. It's gonna be in hex, so it's probably going to be, I mean, what, 2048 divided by 2 is 10, divided by 2 is 5. I feel like it's 8 16s, right? 8 times 16. No, I'm way off. It's 80 16s. That's 2048 divided by 16. Yeah, okay. I knew 8 was around there somewhere. 800. It's not exactly 816s, but it's, yeah, we should see hex 800 for 2048. Or 0800. Oh, yeah, and we do. So this is saying, hey, this is 2048. So that means that we've properly populated the state of our contract. So go us. That's step one. This means, furthermore, that the CID should be authorized based on the contract's logic. So our trusted party right now, through this message, said this CID is authorized. So now the SP on the other side, who's making the public storage deal, can go wild, make this deal, and then claim reward through the Filecoin storage market because the client has said it's good to go. All sorts of ways to make this more interesting. You know, you could do all sorts of other things to add the CID and to pay out to the claimer of the deal, yada, yada, yada. But anyway, yeah, let's stick to the basics. And the next thing to do is actually authorize a deal. So we have the mock market on 2096 or 1096. And what we can do is call it on its method. So this should be a really simple method. So if we go to the mock market, it's just this guy. And so we do this, and then we can go ABI encode, publish deal, bytes address, and then this is that same CBOR data that we saw before. Now this address, I need to get the address of, I'd like to get the Ethereum address of our main contract. That would be this guy. Okay. So we can invoke on our mock market. So the idea to complete the picture here is that a storage provider would get this data somehow. You know, maybe your contract has some nice way to inform them how to get it, like associating a locator along with a CID. It's an interesting extension. Or maybe there's some off-chain party that's like pushing this, but whatever. Eventually the storage provider calls into the market as they do today with direct client deals, and they're gonna call public storage deals. Let me just get this done. So yeah, I think it's just this. This should be enough. Let's see if this works. Okay, cool. Yeah, so basically, so we're mocking out the action of a storage provider who has this data and is about to seal it, or maybe has already started sealing it, and they're pushing it to the chain to say, hey, client, got your data. I would like to be compensated for it. And today, the storage market has its own built-in payment mechanism. There's also this Filecoin Plus thing, which ties the data, ties storing the data to an increase in power at this like deeper protocol level. So there's at least two mechanisms of payment that we can play around with once we have good, true built-in actors integration on Wallaby. But for now, with the mock, I mean, yeah, there might be some things you could do with the mock too right now. For now, I'm doing basically no payments. And okay, cool. So we executed the message. So this is really pretty much the end of our journey. So the thing to really try is, so if you look at this CBOR, and actually, let's actually just look at it. So if you look at the CBOR, you can see that the provider, which if again, we can go all the way back here. So the provider 0 is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is the fifth element. And we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the provider should be 66. In bytes, and I'm just recording the bytes on the mapping. So what we should be able to do is check and see, hey, does our CID bytes and then our provider bytes, does that map to true? If so, we're done. Our contract worked. Let's see, I might have it already in history, not cat. Okay, CID providers, yeah. So that's our CID bytes, that's our provider byte. So that's what we want, and CID providers has this guy. Okay, so let's invoke not on the mock market anymore, but on the client. We'll do that, and we'll do that. So let's see, is the provider tracked as having been authorized on a deal for this data in our client contract? And as we wrap up, hoping that this has all worked, I will again suggest that you read through some of the documentation here, understand the core idea, any trouble building, you can hopefully find a link to this video. And then, yeah, learn a lot about possible ideas. These are mostly ideas that have been floating around for a long time, we've been waiting for in the FEM. Some of them are maybe newer. Probably a lot of people have been thinking about them all at the same time. And while there's better ways to achieve them than this particular work interacting with the built-in storage market, there's better stuff coming. Oh man, I guess I'll finish my thought. This particular way of working is gonna be achievable when we launch FVM, hopefully in February. So, but we have a problem here. So we don't have, looks like we don't have our, looks like we didn't see our provider. So that's a bummer. We would hope this to be one, assuming we saw the provider. So what could be going wrong? CID providers, we sent, let's double check the bytes that we used here. was playing with slightly different bytes. Oh, you know what it was? I think I made the bytes send it to 77. So let's go to CBOR here. Okay. And then, right, internal to this. Aha, so the CBOR I was showing you before was not exactly what I was sending. We are actually sending it to provider 77. So it's no wonder that 66 is not showing up. We didn't actually authorize a deal with 66. We authorized a deal with 77. So let's go back, make that happen. Okay. And let's check. So this should be working. It should just be a matter of us checking for the right provider. So I'll maybe take another chance to explain what I was saying before while we wait. Basically, there's a lot of different ways to think about making the built-in market, or sorry, just making the storage system through the built-in actors interact with user-defined contracts. And the one that this whole project relies on is a bit primitive. It relies on a whole existing payment mechanism and a market actor that was designed for making deals with clients that are not contracts. So it's likely that there's many flaws with this approach that will be superseded by better approaches for integrating with the built-in actors. But this is going to be because that this change encoded through FIP44 is going to exist on mainnet in like a couple weeks. This is really a good place to build, since once M2 FEM launches, you'll be able to use it. But anyway, let's wrap up because, hey, this worked. We see this Boolean 1, and that means that, yes, our provider was added. So I'll just summarize what we did. We built a couple of contracts, and we deployed them to Wallaby, and we added a CID as being authorized by our contract client. And then we actually made a deal with that client. That client said, yes, this is a good deal. And it recorded the provider, which was making the deal. And we checked it using these accessors, and everything seems to be working. So if you're watching this, now it's up to you. Make this basic contract, do something interesting, and try to have fun with it. And if you have really anything built on it that's new, that you're excited about, that you think is cool, you should PR it back to the deal client repo. And then everybody can use it. And hey, that's all for me. I really appreciate you taking the time to watch this, what's become a half-hour video. Hope it's been of some help. Good luck hacking. See you on the internet.